when you get the people there.
Executive Director of GreenLaw, and along with Mindy Goldstein with the Turner Environmental Law Clinic at Emory University. We are delighted to have such a great crowd, half of which registered yesterday. So I thank y'all for bearing out and being patient with us on all the getting the food out and all the utensils and everything. But this is a good problem to have. We're so glad to see so many people out to hear Jan Schlichtmann. I do want to just briefly acknowledge, if you are on the GreenLaw board or advisory board, you could just wave your hand because I am very grateful to y'all for making our work possible. And if you're on the Turner Environmental Law Clinic board or advisory board, you can raise. I know recorders here. So thank y'all for your support. I do want to acknowledge just a few dignitaries. We have our state bar president, Patrice Perkins Hooker, here. Yay! We have past Georgia Bar President and past Georgia Trial Lawyers Association President, Robin Clark. Thank you. And Court of Appeals Judge Ann Barnes. Did I miss any dignitaries? If you think you're a dignitary, raise your hand. Okay, so on with the show. I am delighted that we have two great trial lawyers here today, not only Jan Schlichtmann, but the person who brought Jan Schlichtmann here, and that is Rick Kuykendall, who is a very well-known litigator in his own right. He is one of the chief litigators on the BP oil spill, and I first got to know him because he's on the board of the Surfrider Foundation. And I know Clay Davidson with Surfriders is here. Clay, you want to raise your hand? So if you're interested in Surfrider, they work to protect our oceans. They're surfers for the ocean. It's a really great organization. They've got an active chapter here, and that's how I met Rick Kuykendall. And he's also active with the Riverkeeper organization in Florida, and he litigates all over the country. He's done some coal ash work. He was involved with the Monsanto litigation in Alabama. And so he's here today to introduce us to Jan Schlichtmann. And Rick, tell me your current firm.
I just joined the House Belt firm.
He just joined the House Belt firm in Washington, D.C. So let's please welcome Rick Kuykendall.
I'm sorry, I also meant to say the books are for sale, and I encourage you to please purchase The Civil Action, and also the most recent book that features Jan Schlichtmann's work is Tom's River, and this one, the Pulitzer last year. I just finished reading it. It was a fabulous book. So please stop by and support our local bookseller, Cappella. Thank you.
This one calls us.
Good afternoon. When they say when Bob Dylan first met Johnny Cash, he was sitting in the studio or the offices in New York at Capitol Records, and in walked his towering figure. Dylan was sitting there, and he looked, and the fellow dressed in black, and Dylan got up from his chair, and he just walked around 360 degrees. When he got all the way back to the front, he looked at him, and he went, wow. Well, I have the privilege today to tell you about, rather than just a standard introduction, the guy's got three kids. He lives in Beverly, Massachusetts. He went to Cornell, that kind of thing. You can read about that. I have the privilege today, though, to introduce you to a good friend of mine, colleague, been in the trenches with me. We used to joke about it. being in the box hole together in lots of places. But I have the privilege of introducing you to Jan Schlichtmann. And rather than do those things, like I said, I think I'll share with you a little glimpse into Jan. So it provides you with something that's not in the books. He does have a lovely wife, by the way. He lives in a beautiful house in Beverly, Massachusetts. I've been there, looking out over the ocean. He picked a beautiful spot. And he may share with you why he picked that spot, and he may also share with you what it means to him. Because Jan, unlike a lot of folks from north of the Mason-Dixon, has a real sense of place. And I know that firsthand because Jan and I did some cases together down in Pensacola against some polluters who ruined the bayou down there. And he got to spend a lot of time in the marshlands and the tidal poor lands in Alabama and northwest Florida. We walked those lands and we rode in boats. And we took water samples and we talked a lot. We went out in the Gulf, remember that, Jan? And looked at some of the oil rigs and gas rigs. In doing that, you get a measure of a person. And it's not unlike that sort of returning hero that we've all heard about, it been mysticized by Joseph Campbell. You know, and Campbell did remarkable work on the notion that all societies, from an anthropological view, have always had heroes. And those heroes would go into the unknown world. They'd venture far away from land. They would do all sorts of things. But the measure was the person who came back. And what they told us about the journey. If you haven't read any Campbell's works, I encourage you to do that. Tower of Myth and the like. But I think of Jan, when I think of that, as a hero returning from that type of thing. He faced all sorts of travail in his journeys, many journeys. And he lived to tell the story. So the story of Jan Schlichtmann is not so much about the trial at Woburn or this little bitty fact or that fact. It's really about a hero returning to share with us his stories about what it was like and why he came back. When you listen carefully to what Jan has to say, and I encourage you to do that, because he's got a lot to say, not just about our profession, but about the way we treat our planet, about the way we choose to live as not only lawyers, but citizens with responsibility for our country. So no further than that, I'll just say this. Jan, wow.
The ball. Oh, yes. All right, let me see it.
Is it right for you to go down there?
Absolutely.
All right, I can do anything I want. Huh?
Absolutely.
First of all, thank you so much, and I have to tell you, at 3 o'clock this morning, when I got up, my wife said, whatever you do, put your boots on. Oh, I don't need my boots, you know, listen to your wife. And I tried to get open the door, all those feet of snow, pushed through. Ended up 3:30 in the morning with my second oldest digging the driveway. Is it on? A little lower? Too loud? Yeah. Really? Are you accusing me of being too loud? All right. You can all hear me, though. And digging all of that snow. I know you guys don't know what snow is, but it's white. It covers everything. And it's after you shovel it, you know, 4 or 5 times, 12-hour period gets really heavy, but it makes you ripped, you know, and that's what my doctor said. It was a tear or a rip. But the lunch we just had, one of the benefits is it's in a pouch now, and I'll be able to have it later. So I all urge you to have that experience of shoveling snow. But I made it, you know, I can't believe it. And then, you know, the plane came in, and the clouds parted, and I saw something I hadn't seen for, I can't remember when. Green, brown, blue. You know, and I know this is still winter period here, but you've got colors down here that we haven't seen for a long time. And according to the prognosticators, there's gonna be a much longer time that we're not gonna see those things. So I can't wait, well, I can wait, but I can't wait to get back and tell everybody that there are colors and they're gonna come spring or early summer or whenever the snow leaves. But thank you very much for inviting me, and thank you for, you know, the privilege and the honor. And what an honor to be able to be here for GreenLaw. And I have to tell you, I love that name, GreenLaw. You know, words, there's always a history behind words, but those words, putting those two things together, boy, that speaks to me. GreenLaw. But I know you didn't ask me to come and talk to you about such heavy things. You want to know what it's like to have John Travolta play you. That's why I was invited. That's why I'm always invited. And I think that my mother, who was now visiting another place, she had the best answer when she was asked by a woman who was little and old and Jewish. She said, Travolta? Well, I mean, it could have been Joe Pesci or Danny DeVito. You got a handsome Italian boy playing a nice Jewish boy? What's not to like? So I did well on that score. And it was quite an experience, you know, going through that experience and then having somebody as talented as Jonathan Harr write about it. And you know, people often ask me, did you make any mistakes? And I say, well, read the book, it's 500 pages, there's a mistake on every page. But it was quite an experience, and to have somebody chronicle it as well as he did, to get into the belly of the beast, and then to have a movie, pretty good movie, it's a very, I'll tell you, it was therapeutic. And actually coming here to talk to you is part of the therapy that I have been consigned to live and relive again. But I'm glad to relive it. I really am. For a long time, I ran away from the experience. And you flatter me, you honor me, and you make me feel like maybe it was really all worthwhile to say, hey, did you learn something? Would you mind sharing what you learned? Hard to say no to that. So thank you for giving me an opportunity to chat with you. I do have some things to say, you know, and I want to say them. And since you've invited me here, I'm going to do it. Because I'm disturbed like you. You know, there's this disquietude. And I have to tell you, the disquietude that comes from I'm sure that maybe, you know, those little beads of perspiration on a hot day here in Atlanta, when maybe it's just a little too hot for a little too long, or maybe that disquietude that I just had, you know, yesterday and the day before that, when you're shoveling the third or the fourth or the fifth time with the third and the fourth and the fifth snowstorm in 2 weeks, and there is this disquietude, this uneasiness. Maybe there's something going on. Maybe there's just something going on that's a little different, that says a little something about who and what we are and how we treat each other and the earth. And maybe we need to talk about that. And I have to tell you, I did go through this experience, and it does inform a lot of my thinking. And, you know, people stop me and, they've read the book, I've seen the movie, and they'll say things, or they'll maybe have not met me, and they'll write about it or say something to others that gets, you know, finds my ears. They'll say things like, oh yeah, greedy lawyers. It was greedy lawyers. That explains what happened there. Oh, someone else says, oh no. Mendacious lawyers. Mendacious lawyers. Oh, that's it. Mendacity. Lying, cheating, stealing. Somebody else will read it. Most people will read it and say, oh no, bad judge. I love that one, the bad judge. A bad judge, I've learned that the definition of a bad judge is the judge who ruled against you. And by that standard, I have only had in my career bad judges. The bad judge. Well, you know what? Yes, there was greed. Yes, there was mendacity. And there was bad decision making. But it was not monopolized by one. And what I've come to appreciate is that it wasn't this behavior. Those were merely symptoms of an underlying pathology. There was a thinking, a way of looking at things that drove out those parts of the human character which are not the healthiest. and tamp down those parts of the human nature which we need if we're ever going to get from where we are to where we got to go. If we're ever going to get to a safer, healthier, better place as we dig out of the toxic legacy of the past century. So when people, you know, come and they talk about this experience and they want to know if I learned anything, you know, I think the best way to, well, is to tell you is that, you know, when people come and say, you know, what are we going to do about what we're doing to the environment? Or what are we going to do about what the environment's doing to us? And I think about, you know, I've had some time, now in my sixth decade, I can't believe that, my sixth decade. I think about the thinking before, and I think there has to be a new kind of thinking. That we have to change the thinking that's changing the climate. That we have to change about how we look at things, and I believe that we, as lawyers, have a special responsibility to think about who we are, what we are, and why they come to us. You know, I remember early part of the 1980s, and the words came out of someone who had a very high level in the judiciary, the highest level you can go in our system, and he was giving a talk to our fellow members of the bar, and he stunned everybody when he said, it is time for us to be healers of the law. What an interesting thought. Of course, it meant nothing to me at the time, healers of the law, but it means so much to me now. Healers of the law. What a concept. You know, when they came to me, the mothers of Woburn, they came to me and they told me their story. You know, I thought like a lawyer, my training and my experience, and I said, you know, when people come to me and they tell this story, I got to go look to see if I can make a case out of it. And if I can, I can help. And if I can't, I can't. You know, who did this to you? You know, and when? Well, authorities don't know. Oh. Well, you got to have a wrongdoer, but we don't know who that is. Well, we got contaminated wells. That's got to be wrong. But and we have these children, these families who came to me, the mothers with their children who were sick. Filled with questions, and your children sick and dying of cancer, leukemia. And, well, I knew that was a terrible disease. Sure, the law would recognize that as an injury, but there's got to be that connection, a thing called causation. Did your doctors tell you that the water was responsible? Oh, no, the doctors don't know. Oh, the doctors don't know. Hmm. And I'm thinking, am I going to be able to get a doctor or scientist, you know, in this country to be able to talk about such things? And, you know, after they sober up, what kind of witness would they be? No. I just knew this was not a case for me. I was too young. Hair was too dark. I had too many things. I was smart enough to know I didn't have the wisdom, I didn't have the experience, and I didn't have the resources to do such a thing. And I told them, no. But these were folks who wouldn't take no for an answer. Well, I was young and didn't know how to take no or give no so that people would take it as the answer. And I had to come back again to a place like this. And, you know, I said, okay, look, I'll go talk to the older ones, the experienced ones, the ones with more resources. I'll see if they can help me. Oh, I said, okay, great, thank you, young man. And I went, I knocked on the doors of the older ones, the wiser ones, the ones with more resources. I found out why they were older, wiser, with more resources. They said, no, thank you, we're busy. Okay, thank you, great. Good luck, kid. Thanks. All right. Okay, look, I got to tell you the truth. I can't help you. I can't help you. Do you know what they did? Do you know what the mothers of Woburn did? They held their children up to me. They said, don't you get it? Our children, they're choking death on the lies. We need the truth. The truth. I'm a lawyer. The truth. You gotta go and you try and take the truth from others and they don't want to give it to you, and you know, and there's a lot of challenge and trouble and time, and let me think about it. So I did. I do it like lawyers did. I did that thinking, you know, when they were all training, and then I did what you do, you know, I got out of the office and I got the shoes dirty. Yes, I did. I did my job and checked things around, and companies. Two large companies. Two extremely large companies. In fact, at that time, one was $6 billion, one was $8 billion. It shows you what went for large in those days, how far we've come. These were two of the largest corporations in the world. Features Foods and Bureau Grace. Big companies. Well, then there are the rumors. You know the rumors. People pay huge sums of money for this. And oh, I have to tell you, I was thinking about it all. I did, you know, and I was here in my office. You know how it is. I did lawyer thinking, you know. I thought about the children. And I thought about the challenge. Then the treasure. And I went to my partners. And they said, hey, we got to do this thing. And they said, hey, all for one and one for all. And we were in and on and joined the families on, as Rick says, a journey. And the journey that Rick talks about, when you go on such a thing, that is a horse that takes you to the places you have never been before. And it rides hard, and all you do is hang on for dear life. That was one of these experiences. A magic horse went very far, as Rick says, and yeah, I did come back, but not quite the person that rode out. You see, this was really interesting. We had to, well, we tried to approach it like a lawyer. You know, I went to an expert. And then this one, he sent me to another one. He said, oh, no, you got to go to this other one. So I went to the other one, and this other one, and this other one. And I said, oh, look, this is too confusing. So we just decided to do it. No corporation, no institution of higher learning, no government ever done before. We decided to bring all of the ologists into one room at one time and one place like this to talk about, share their information and their insights to try and figure out what had happened here. Because the families had said, you know, we have counted the numbers of children with this disease. You know, the government had done their testing. The wells were contaminated with these chemicals that nobody had ever heard before. And the families had counted the numbers of children with this disease, leukemia, and there were too many. But the government couldn't tell who did the contamination. And the Center for Disease Control and State Mass Department of Health couldn't tell the families if the water was responsible. And so in order to do this thing that no one had ever done before, we had to try and figure it out. And so these folks in the room tried to figure it out the way people with smarts, with training, with experience, and with desire to do it in a room like this, talking and sharing. And they did. And we learned some things. You know, we learned about the contamination and, we learned about the activities. We learned about, you know, making a thing. And we learned about, that when you make things, you make waste. And then we learned about the chemical constituents of that waste. And then we learned about that waste and where they dumped it. And then where it went. And then what happened to folks when it got there. You know, we learned about, we were told when we started the journey that the water has such small quantities of these chemicals in the water. It's just too little. I joke when I hear that now, you know, with several hundred parts per billion of these chemicals. Too little, they said. Yes, well, you know what? It wasn't so little that the body doesn't know that the chemical is there and tries to get rid of it. And the act of trying to get rid of it, it breaks that little strand, that little life strand, and in that broken strand, a cancer can take root. You know, when we did some studies and they said, well, you know, just small quantities in the water, too small, and most of the people didn't drink the water. But you know, we found it did come from drinking. No. You see, these chemicals volatilize, came out of the toilet and the dishwasher and the shower where the greatest exposures occurred. In fact, just living in the home with that, I love this word, enriched air was the exposure. Huh. I have to tell you about these meetings. I know you lawyers will appreciate this. Because I sat there, you see, and I heard from this one and that one and this one and that one, and they all get very exciting, but I'll tell you, the only excited fellow there in that room is me. Because you know what? I can do this! I can do the case that nobody's ever done before! I can be the one to do the case that's never been done before. Let's do it. And so we did. We did what a lawyer does. You know, we drew that thing up. It told the story the way we want the story told. We paid the fee. They just changed the fee, I remember, from a $50 filing fee to $500 per plaintiff. I remember getting the invoice for the complaint. What I really remember is that was just the first surprise. It was a very expensive complaint. But I filed it, and I got what the law gives you. You know what the law does, gives you power. Yes, I took that power. You know that power. That power that lets you to do things that other folks who don't have what we've got can't do. I got the power to go on their property. I got the property, and I got to look at things. And I did, and I found something that I had not really had too much experience with. Pits. You know pits? I learned about pits. Pits, they're dug by people, you know, to bury things. Something else about pits I learned. They're deep, they're dark, they're dirty, and they're dangerous. I learned something else about pits. When you jump into somebody else's pit and you start digging, sometimes you end up digging your own. Oh. Something else about pits and jumping into people's pits and looking for the dirt, digging the dirt. They usually return the favor, invade your property, and start digging in and finding things that you buried. Oh, wait a minute. And with all that invasion, there was conflict. And with conflict, there was war. War. And that's the word to describe it. And I know as citizens and people, we get a lot of experience with war, but we lawyers, we have experience with war every single day. That desire to take your hands and place them around the skinny little or fat little neck of your opponent and finally liberate the life from their body because you are right and they are wrong. Yes. And the world will be safer for my doing it. It needs killing. We understand that. We all got that. And we had it in Woburn, and Woburn was like on a class that was just beyond any experience I had before. It was the most longest, it was the most expensive. It was, I remember there were days of depositions that there were 16 depositions going around this country the same day, day after day. That's too many for one lawyer to go to, as you can imagine. But we did. We managed to get through this period. I remember those times. The power of depositions. You know, that wonderful engine to discover the truth. Yes, I remember it. You know what? I remember when they summoned my headologist. I think that's the best way to describe him. He was the best of the best. And they put him in there, you know, that experience. They put the little pains over here, and they put the little penalties over there, guaranteed to squeeze the truth out of anybody, pains and penalties, them in the middle. And I remember that lawyer, for Beatrice, he was the best, asking those questions, going over his opinion. And then near the end, he said, well, now, doctor, I got just one more question. Name the study that shows the children exposed to this contamination of water makes them sick. Gives him cancer. Name the study. And I remind you, doctor, you're under oath. Well, the doctor didn't have to be reminded. He said, there are none. But ask me that. Ask me that a little later. So what do you mean? Well, this will be the study. And I remember sitting there in the room thinking, is that study going to come out before or after the trial? I remember those engines, you know, because he had his day, okay, where I had to go sit there. We all love that thing, right? Where you sit there and you watch the other side pull your intestines out, you know, how long. I learned how many feet of intestines one has. There's a lot of feet of intestines that can be pulled out by your opponent. But anyway, now it's your turn, my turn. And I'm the one. And I put pains over there, and I put penalties over there, and I put their guy right there. And I ask them the question. The important question. What chemicals did you use? What did you do with them? And where did they go at the end of the day? Where'd you put them? Nothing. Nothing. I remember there was Al Love. He sat there. getting nowhere, taking a break. I remember talking to my partner, Kevin. Oh, gee, you know, I don't know, you know, not really getting anywhere. He says, yeah, you're not getting anywhere. I tell you what, man, it came to my attention that he lives across the street from Ann Anderson, and he's got a big family, lots of kids. Why don't you ask him if he is concerned about the water? He thinks there's a connection. I said, Kevin, that is the most ridiculous. Okay, I did. And when I did, the lawyer on the left laughed, and the lawyer on the right laughed. But I noticed something, that Al, he wasn't laughing. He said he got a headache that day that didn't go away until he walked across the street to Ann Anderson's house, and he shared with her what he knew, and then the two of them came and shared that with me, and then the three of us went and shared it with the U.S. attorney, and it was the first time that he then shared it with a grand jury, and then it was the first time that a Fortune 500 company ever been indicted for lying to the EPA about its use of chemicals. You know, I remember there was the tannery employee sitting there. And I remember there was Tom Mernon, the city engineer, who sat there. I remember the city engineer, he lived across the street from the Toomeys. Their son Patrick died of leukemia. And I remember Tom Mernon lived across the street. You know, Richard would go across the street and say, Tom, come in here. You got to look at this water. There's something wrong here. Oh, no, Richard, it's the pipes. Oh, yeah, the pipes. Oh, okay. And then came the trial. And during the trial, he was called, Mr. Mernon was called by the other side, by the best. And they asked him, you know, when did the wells go on and when did the wells go off? And he testified, but not so truthfully. But then, sometime later, he got cancer. And on his deathbed, he confided to the family's reverend, he said, it touched me too. It touched me too. I do remember the tannery employee asking him pains and penalties. Nothing. But then I remember we had that verdict. We got one company, another company, but not Beatrice. I remember we went on appeal. And the day we filed the appeal, the tannery closed down, broke the contract. And that afternoon, I was in the kitchen of the tannery employee. The kitchen. That sacred little place. And in the kitchen, he shared with me what he knew. And what he shared with me made me angry. And I went to someone else, and I got angrier still. And I got really angry, and so I confronted the best. I looked at that lawyer, you know, he had those eyes. And I made the demand. It was rightful to make. Where is it? The lawyer said, oh, you want the truth? Yes, damn it! Oh, the truth. Well, we buried it over there. Which one? Which bit? Oh, we buried it in the bottomless one. Oh, and I jumped in, I pushed my partners aside, put everybody aside, I jumped into the pit, and I started to dig a flurry of digging, but you cannot get to the bottom of such a place. No, and I had to rest. And then I saw in the diggings interesting things, glittery things, like silver and gold. Why, this was evidence of false testimony. Well, this was evidence that had been withheld, and this was evidence of false testimony. Well, that's perjury. And I just got excited. I took all that glittery stuff, and I stuffed it in my pockets, and I went to the place where a lawyer in such a situation goes. You know that place. We're all familiar with it. And I laid out that glittery stuff in front of a federal judge. We don't have any federal judges here, do we? But we all know, being in front of a federal judge, that sometimes they can get angry. And after I laid out all that glittery stuff, this federal judge got angry. In fact, he got as angry as a federal judge can get, and they can get pretty angry. I remember standing there, big smirk on my face. Oh, he was getting angry, but not at them, at me, for digging it all up. And he said, it's too late for the truth. Closed the book, and out I went, his words ringing in my ear. So I went to that place that all lawyers go. You're not allowed to talk to the folks inside. Very important. You want to talk to them, you're not allowed to talk to them. You have to write it all down. You know, you got to say, right this wrong.
And you can't talk to them, you slip it in the door, you wait, wait, oh, someone comes back, and it's written all down, and then you say, well, wait a minute, you wrote this wrong. And they say, oh, I'm sorry, that's what we do, that's it. They send me to another place, and I knocked on the door, the biggest door a lawyer can knock on. I remember that. And there you're supposed to do what they call a petition. And all you lawyers are very familiar with this process. You stand outside and you say, help! And eventually a little man comes and he says, I'm sorry, but the judges, they're a little busy. Thank you. And then I had to go home. Well, in order to get home, I went to my car. It was gone. I ran to my condo. That was gone. I was realized I'm naked without clothes. No condo, no car, no clothes, no credit, and no colleagues, no career, nothing. I looked around and there was no thing nest. So I did what any self-respecting human being would do in such a circumstance. I got the hell out of town. I went as far as you can go in this country and still be in this country, in Hawaii, and had my midlife crisis there. And when you have it, I urge all of you to go there. It's a beautiful place, a helpful place. And I did, and I tried to escape my past. No law, no past. It didn't work. Something interesting did happen, though. You see, all the stuff that we had shared with the families, with the EPA, they said, change of administration, they said, well, you know, the families are right. And they brought the folks, the companies, to a place like this, and at a place like this, they shared with them what they do. And at the end of all that sharing, the companies, they agreed to do a $70 million cleanup. It'll take 50 years. And over here, I decided it was time to go back home, and so I made my way home. But when I made my way home, something interesting happened. You see, I went to that granite headland cliff, the one that Rick talked about earlier. You see, I went on that granite headland cliff, my home, and when I went there, I was forced to confront my past, and all I could have was the pain. Oh, the pain and the failure, and it was just too much, you see. And so distracted, I tumbled all the way over the edge, and I have to tell you, flailing wildly, I managed to grab hold of the outstretched fingers of a branch, and I held on for dear life. You know, but in my tired state, you know, I couldn't see a way up, and I couldn't see a way out, and I just closed my eyes to accept my fate. And you know, it was in that long, endless moment, swinging between life and death, that I realized that I was holding something in my hand, something vital. And this thought was like energizing, and I realized that the branch, it leads to a limb, I grabbed it. And the limb leads to a trunk, and I grabbed it, and then from the trunk to solid ground. And I was so excited by my accomplishment that I decided to stay right here in this place. And I stayed so long that I became rooted in this place. I got married. And through a power which I still cannot explain, two sons came forth. I know how it happened, but how did that happen? Two more reasons to want to stay safely rooted in this place. Something else interesting happened. You see, Jonathan's book came out. And then the phone calls, always on a Sunday. Hey, I read this book about you lawyer and you. You gave up everything for your clients, including your sanity. You sound like just a lawyer for me. I'm married. I'm tired. No. Phone rings, and it's a mother. Hi. A mother from Toms River, New Jersey. She said, you know, we got some contaminated wells down here. We got two large companies, it's always two large companies, and we got a lot of children with cancer, and they're dying. And we're wondering if you learned something, and if you wouldn't mind just coming down and sharing with us what you learned. Well, I couldn't say no to her. Okay, I did. And I went to that place, that sacred place, their living room, and there we shared with each other what we knew. And at all that end of sharing, we decided to do something strange and interesting. We decided to become partners. I love that word. Partners, you know, you look out for each other. Partners, they share responsibility, they do things together, and they know that all resources are limited. And then we went and formed a partnership with the state government, local government, federal government, and then we did something really strange. We decided to knock on the doors of the lawyers for the other side and offer a partnership, and guess who should answer the door but the lawyer for Beecher's Foods? Ah! Well, it's not like we didn't have something to talk about. And we did. You see, we went to a place like this. We started to share with each other what we knew. Weeks, months, year, two. We share with each other things we were finding, and in the middle of all that sharing, we decided to bring a third party in that might be able to help. And at the end of 3 years, interesting thing happened. We came to an agreement, the way lawyers can, an agreement that gave the families the economic tools to dig out of the rubble of that experience. Woburn, 9 years, millions. Tom's River, 3 years, hundreds. And I have to tell you, something else interesting happened. You see, change of administration, Center for Disease Control, looked at the work that we had shared about the families and said, you know, the families were right, the water was responsible. And that night, summer's night, in Woburn, all the families and us gathered together, the government announced, first time in history, there was a connection between the water and the blight of cancer. And I remember going home that night, I remember going home and the company of the families, not as many as when we first started, but I remember something interesting. I felt no pain. Yes, it had been 15 years since Jimmy Anderson died, but I realized something. It wasn't too late for the truth. The truth. It's not something you have to go and get. The truth. It's not something you have to go and take from someone. No, 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 the truth. It's all around us. And all we have to do, it will come to us if we share experience. And when we share experience, soil is created in which life takes root. What a thought. And I have to tell you, from that moment until this moment, I've had a lot of time to think. And today brought it home, like it always does, one way or another, when I went from that white, where I knew something was buried underneath, and thanks to you, I'm reminded that there is something there. And I suggest to you, and maybe you need a coating of white, I suggest to you that that thing that's always trying to poke out is trying to, perhaps has a lesson to share with us. And I think it might be this, the lesson that branch that was extended to me. It may be this simple. When we think about how we get from here to there, when we think about the metaphor that should propel us, maybe we should take our inspiration from life itself and the lesson every day it tries to teach us, that when life is shared, life is given, so life can go on. What a thought. And maybe that should be our guiding principle as lawyers. When they come to us, sickened by their problem, maybe we should be healers of the rift. And in that way, perhaps we may help others learn to live on and with this earth together. Thank you. Without my nose running, obviously. It is running, but you don't see it. If I don't get any Kleenex, they will see it. We will spare you from that. This will be excised from the tape. Thank you very much. Some unsolicited. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm sitting right in front of you.
Oh, you can see it?
No.
All right, like it never happened. Did Stephanie want me some questions? Yes?
Yeah.
If you all would like to fire away or ask some questions about what all that means, or are you serious? I'd be happy to answer them. Yeah.
Thank you. That was beautiful. It just seems to me it illustrated how we need to look at the life cycle of Mother Earth and trees growing. But I have a question. First environmental movement, Teddy Roosevelt, a Republican. Second, Richard Nixon. A Republican in the Republican Congress that created water, air, and hazardous waste laws.
Yeah.
The third environmental movement, I believe, was people and businesses saying sustainability makes sense economically, and they brought it up to churches and local governments and states and EPA. But that happened with conservatives and liberals, however you want to characterize them. How do we, what's happened now, and how can we get back to the roots?
To me, it's the metaphors. You know, the metaphors that propelled us long ago were the metaphors of belching smokestacks and burning rivers and littered landscapes. Those metaphors are not the metaphors that should be driving us now when you have a burning planet and a scale, you know, human impact on a scale that has just never been imagined. And we have to have the metaphors to catch up with that in order to drive the thinking that hopefully will change the thinking that is changing the climate. And we have to come up with these metaphors. And it's not the monopoly of a liberal or a progressive or a conservative or, you know, it's not that at all, or of a child or an old person. It's not that at all. I believe that the awakening that we need to have as human beings is that this is our home that we are rooted on, and we have to think of everything that we do the way life does, which is life has learned to live with life. And if we choose as a species not to do that, if we're driven by this metaphor that's extractive and destructive to the extent of life, then that metaphor only conclusion is going to be the one that I was driven by. It is a bankrupting metaphor. It is bankrupting financially, resource-wise, spiritually, morally. We have to change the thinking. It must be a chemistry that works with life, a science that works with life, a new kind of thinking, green chemistry, environmental technologies, ways of, you know, energy capture and energy use that do things the way nature does. Biomimicry, learning, taking our inspiration from life. All those things, and I believe it will have to change us as lawyers as well, because if we use the conflict paradigm, this extractive, destructive paradigm, which we are really good at, then how are we going to ever expect an extractive, destructive paradigm with pains and penalties as the way we think about how you extract truth, which I say is by nature non-productive? How is that, which requires the truth, as Brandeis said, justice is but truth in action, how is a system that is really poor at extracting the truth going to be able to solve problems in which we need to know the truth of what happened? If this system doesn't get it right, that's supposed to solve our problems, then how are we going to help folks get it right? How are we going to help them when they come to us? Whoever comes in that door, whether it's the owner of a big company or the owner of a little house like Ann Anderson, it really doesn't matter. The answer that we give, I suggest to you, must be a life-affirming answer that gets to solve the problem. There is a difference between Woburn and Tom's River in approach, and it was all by the same people who were trained, all the same thing. We just brought the better out of us and not the worst out of us, and that's what we need to do. It's changed me as a lawyer. Now, I'm just like you every day, and I want to, yes, if God would only give me the little chance. Come on, one time, just let me get my hands around that, only in a few seconds. It'll be over. But for reasons only God knows, I've never had the chance, thank you. All right. You gotta do it another way. It takes two to have conflict. And I've tried, I've employed these practices, other lawyers have, and I'm telling you, it's surprising that when you, that angry voice on the other end of the phone, not matched by yours, and I'm very capable of doing it, that angry memo, not matched by yours, it gets really hard for there to be a fight among one. I've noticed that. It's very hard. It takes a lot of discipline. But if you can't control someone else's behavior, but you can control your own. And if we think about it more, if we're more mindful of it, if our words change from demand to request, if the things by which we do little things, big things, can come from it, we can encourage the sit down. And the sit down in a room like this is the only place where problems get really solved. We know that. It is not and cannot be in the courtroom. It just can't. It's because things are not getting solved that we go there. But we have to design a process that takes the best of this rather than suffering the worst of what happens in a formal setting in which truth is not as respected as in a place like this where people are voluntarily sharing information. So that's the thing I learned. And so as a lawyer, the more I can encourage this and sitting down and talking, and as soon as you sit down, you're respecting, and as soon as you're respecting, you're building, and as soon as you're building, who knows what you could construct, as opposed to anger and destruction. And we all know what happens with destruction. Nothing. So, yes.
Before the Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, EPA acts were passed, it seems to me, and I've asked this before and haven't really gotten very far with it, maybe you can help. There was a lot of groundwork done by Senator Gaylord Nelson, as I think of as the main one. And he did a lot of education at the Senate and the rest of the Congress, my understanding, and formed groups, and they were an inspirational person. But do you, as you draw on your experience around the country, do you see anyone in public life even partly analogous to him that we can sort of look to for public leadership?
I think there is great hope on the progressive side, liberal side, that Al Gore would fill that role, and I think had an opportunity to do that, and he is doing great, fantastic work for sure. But it has to come from the grassroots as well. And the great thing, if you remember, one day, something really interesting happened. One person had a thought, why don't we invite everybody to sit and do something nobody's ever done before and think about the earth for one day. And on that one day, 20 million people showed up. Now, 20 million people then went out and energized millions and millions more, and within that two-year period, almost all the environmental laws, with all the good names, Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, Environmental Policy Act, Endangered Species Act, you name it, in that two-year golden period, those laws, all the ones that we're now arguing about, should we dismantle, should we change, do we really need them, if you're fracking, why do you really need all of this stuff, it just gets in the way, and all that kind of stuff. If we're having this conversation, 50 years, is it 50, my God, or almost, years later, about changing these good laws with the good names, I suggest we need an awakening. And the awakening can only come from one speaking to another, like we're talking, and a receptiveness by all of us that maybe the fifth time of shoveling, and maybe that extra sweating, maybe we do have to talk to each other, because maybe there is something going on here that we're all contributing to, and if we don't change, then something else is going to change, and it may be a change that will come to bite us in a place that we don't like to be bitten. Yeah?
Of course, the comment. I just saw the best credits of CLE I've ever seen. The second is, your lawsuit was a product of a post-industrial society.
Yes.
And we still, the main issues today have to do with energy, the fuel, coal and gas. And statutes have not been sufficient.
Right.
So how do you see the common law going? In other words, trespass, nuisance, et cetera.
So, hoping that the law is going to propel us forward, I know that was in my mind, it was a well-intentioned theory. It came out of the place, I think the name of it, in New Haven, I think it's located. And a good place, good education there. And there was that thinking that, maybe we could, the law could be used as something that would make us better than we are, but would propel us forward, that would demand of us something. And I know that that is a metaphor and a thinking that many of us adhere to. But I, after being in this thing now, and I was counting the years today, I cannot believe it. Can it be four decades? I just don't think the law, as I've come to know her, him, it, is really the thing we should be depending upon to propel us. I think the law is better as responding to what we as a society decide is the right thing to do. I don't think it's the law that says it's right for someone of color not to be discriminated against. I don't think that's what happened first. I think it was all of us demanding it was time. And I think that's true in the environmental field and every other field of law. The law will accelerate, perhaps, but we as a people have to decide. I don't believe in imposing. I've learned that an imposition of force is very limited, and I think our recent history and time in which we thought with all that power we could just stamp it out and eradicate it, and lo and behold, after all that application of unbelievable force, something more horrible took its place. How did that happen? Maybe it's a problem with the imposition of force. Maybe if we want to solve a problem, rather than trying to cut it out, maybe we need to heal it, heal the body from within. Maybe we need to think on every level, and certainly on the law level, that imposition of force is not the answer. Perhaps must be, perhaps, a last resort, but in very limited circumstances. I think the best answer always is, how can we help folks understand what happened and encourage that healing, the healing of the rift? Now that's, you know, for most people, most of the time, we would rather have our problem solved so we can go on with our life. But we've all seen it. People become toxified by their problem and have this unbelievable addiction to it. And your biggest problem of a lawyer is trying to get them to give up the addiction to the problem, that it actually can be solved if they wish it to be. That's the skill set that we need to learn and apply in our practice, the healing aspect. That, and I think, broadly speaking, is the one we need as a society, as a national community, as a world community. We have to decide this is the right thing and start putting in the energy, a little bit every day, all of us shared, that gets us to the next place. But that's going to come from change thinking, where we begin to share a common metaphor that works with life. Science, demanding that science work with life before it starts denying life. A chemical, right, that we all make use of, but a life, a chemical that takes its inspiration from nature so it can be digested by nature, because that's what nature does. You know, one bacteria's waste product is another bacteria's lunch. I mean, that's how it all works. And maybe we should begin to think like that as well with our technology. It needs to fit in with life, not deny it. Because at the end of the day, we're being denied by it. Yes?
So we share a lot of views. We actually share a view of Salmon Sound. And the smokestacks in Salmon Sound used to be the big ugly coal plant.
Right, so going down. Went down.
Went down, and now it's been replaced with a
gas plant.
Well, a little bit, right?
Well, no. 60 years of being under the tyranny of the coal stacks, replaced now with 60 years being under the tyranny of the gas stacks, is, in my mind, not the bridge to salvation. That's a bridge to a place I do not want to go. So, I disagree. I think it is time for us to think about energy the way life thinks about energy, and to start thinking about how we can use life's energy, and there's plenty of opportunities. Just think about this, you know, it was like in Woburn. There were no studies. Because we didn't have the money? No, because the folks who do studies with money decided that that wasn't a good investment of money. What did the families demand? We do the studies. When they said, well, there's no money, okay, then we'll go do it, and they did it. They challenged the scientists from the school, Harvard School of Public Health, and they said, let's go up and let's go do the study no one's ever done before. They did it, and they found out, lo and behold, the children, there was a connection between the disease and the water, and that's now been in peer-reviewed journals. It took 9 years, but you know, it got in there, and then it was reconfirmed by the government. So no, I say, no, I think that we have to begin to put the resources of brain power and some of our resources into thinking about energy. If we put a small fraction of what we put into what has been invested in fossil fuel energy extraction, I dare say we'll find some pretty good substitutes in a fairly short period of time, because we are running out of that time. I think the clock is ticking a lot faster than people think, so I would urge that investment be made now. So I don't think replacing one 60-year tyranny with another 60-year tyranny, we don't got 60 years. They say that in my home, I'm 6 feet above the tide, you know, when it's high. My grandchildren, or maybe just my children, may have to build the house up on stilts. So I say we don't have the time. Yes?
When we arrived here before the luncheon, we went up, by the time we got to the 11th level of the parking garage, we did see a car that was hooked up to a power cord.
Yes.
I think it was on the fifth floor.
Sure.
There was one.
That's one. Let me tell you, though, I don't think we lose hope. think about history. The changes that happen with technology can happen at blinding speed. They really can. You just think about the telephone, the electric bulb, and the light was a lot, you know, simpler then. We can change pretty fast. And I dare say when the guy showed up, they were all shivering in the cave, and the guy showed up with that bright, shiny thing, and they said, did you get that? the volcano thing, I don't know, it's kind of interesting. I thought I'd bring it home. Oh, gee, it feels good. I mean, I dare say that that idea, in a time when they had no iPhones, I bet you that thing spread pretty fast as feet could fall. So I say the technology, a good one, can take over, and I know it's coming. I know we will do it, but I would like to accelerate it by investing a little more brain power and money into making it happen.
The collaborative model that you discussed and that you talk about at Toms River is discussed in the book. Is that your exclusive model of practice these days? Do you ever see a courtroom, or is the courtroom like your past life? And because it seems,
what time is it right now? In 30 minutes, I have to be on a call in a courtroom. So to answer your question, when I look at my docket, I don't see a lot of Toms River stuff going on there. I see a lot of litigation. Okay, smartass, what's going on here? It isn't easy. But what I try and do is remove the opportunities for conflict. I try and limit, you know, as much as possible, the opportunities for conflict, and things move faster. And we do get to this place a lot faster, I find. And I preserve relationships. Even when they don't want to be warm and cuddly, I, you know, try and do what I can about, oh, how warm and cuddly you are. You know, and come on over for a coffee. So I try and introduce these concepts as much as I can, and it works wonders in the practice. But it's not a panacea, and we got a long way, you know, to go. It has to be a shared thing. People all have to agree to it. But I do see lawyers being receptive. In the end of the day, lawyers really do get a charge about solving problems. They really do. We all experience it. It's a lot of fun solving the problem, going on to the next one. It's not really fun for anyone, I don't care what side of the V, to have a problem linger. And as we all know, Jarndyce against Jarndyce, we have a system in which problems can linger. And litigation is not a good business. It's a going out of business business. So it's really good when our clients don't go out of business because, and they don't get into the litigation business, which is not a really good business to get into. So I say that we can encourage this behavior. I have done it, I'm getting older, I just don't have the time, you know? So I try these things, and they do work. But it's not, peaches and cream. I guess you guys know about peaches here, and I'm lactose intolerant, but whatever. Yeah, yes, we're all set.
One more question.
One more question, where? You call. Go ahead. One for you. You can call someone. I can't see.
Yeah, are there any more questions?
Yeah.
I've got one. Your cooperation model, the consensus model, is extremely attractive, but if one assumes that people do act rationally, but they act rationally within their own self-interest,
yes,
the reality is the conflict model is extremely profitable for the legal industry. As one has been caught up in it, what insight do you have of how do you deal with the fact that the conflict model works?
Doesn't.
Maybe not for businesses.
Doesn't. It's not profitable. And I'm telling you right now, it isn't profitable for anybody. Go ask Bill Gates. And he's got more of everything than anybody else has got. It is not profitable. It steals the most precious thing of all. Far more valuable than money. Yes. The only thing God gave us, right? Didn't give us the money. Why not? Okay. You got some time to think about it. Okay, I got it. Time. We need the time. And we lawyers should not be taking money to take from our clients what they desperately need, which is time. We need to give them time. And time means solve their past so they can have a future. So it is not profitable. It's not good for the defense, it's not good for the folks that they represent, and it's not good for everyone else. It is not profitable. It is not. And we need to, and I'm telling you right now, I dare say, I'm not saying something's going to shock you, we are putting ourselves out of business. Do you think they're really going to start keep paying these bills that they keep seeing? Really? Do you think so? You don't think after a while somebody's going to ask a question like, well, wait a minute, I thought, you know, I brought this problem into you, and not only is it It was this size, now it's that size, and the bill is this size. Don't you think maybe they'll say, you know, how about making the problem this size and maybe the bill about the same size? And that is what we have to do. And if we don't, I'm telling you, they'll shut the show down. They'll figure it out after a while. They will shut us down. You already see the thing. So we have to come up with the ways that's more profitable for people to solve their problems. We are stealing time, and we need to stop.
If you want CLE credit, there's a sign up and there's a $5 charge. If you're writing a check, it's to the CLE, ICLE. And thank you so much for coming. If you're coming this evening, it's 6 to 8 p.m. at Laura Turner and Rutherford Seidel's home, and you can come to me if you need directions or address or anything. It's not too late to sign up if you want to come to see us. Thank you.
I'm good. How are you?
That was great.
Oh, yeah.
Hey. No?
What?
I think I can probably agree with that.
I guess you can't do this. This is fiction.
That's a great movie.
Yeah. Runaway Jury. Don't know what that's about.
This was filmed, I think, in Georgia, wasn't it? Maybe. No. No, it wasn't. Sorry.
These are films about justice, right?
Yeah.
Real justice. R-E-E-L justice. I love that.
Very cool.
Hey, did you know I'm now a member of the Teamsters film crew?